love me, yeah they love me. First love yourself. For that, and God we trust. Trust me, I don't trust myself. Your jewelry, I get it too.
Welcome back to It Is What It Is. This episode is sponsored by Underdog Fantasy. The app is an easy way to make some cash just by making picks on your favorite players. Underdog is available in more than 30 states, including California, Florida, Texas, and New York, just to name a few. Make sure to support the show by hitting the link in the bio and downloading the Underdog Fantasy app. They'll also match your first deposit up to $100, and you get a special pick when you sign up. I'm Treasure Wilson, aka Stat Baby, along with your hosts Mace and Cam.
Yo, Killer, what's good, man?
Murda.
How you doing, Murda, man?
What's up, baby?
Man.
I'm good, man. No, I'm in Miami. I love the way we filming that, but I do miss this weather, man. I can't lie, man. The weather's beautiful, man. The weather's beautiful. What's good, baby? What happened?
Yeah, today was a rough day, man.
What happened?
You didn't see what happened?
I had a few appointments.
Huh?
Nah, I've been running around. I have a few appointments today. What we was talking about, I missed out. Everything was going on. What happened?
I was just wondering how you feel about you know, them guys talking about Damon Dash, a fellow Harlem guy, since you're from Harlem.
Who was talking about him?
Steve Stout and Shannon Sharp.
Oh, I did see that. I've seen that.
You saw that?
You see what Dame's response was?
Oh, no, I ain't see his response. If he responded, I don't have to respond. But what you was thinking?
I'm going to read you, because I've been moving around. I seen it briefly, but I'll read you real quick what Dame wrote. Well, everybody could go on the internet and see what Steve said. And Dame, what is Dame? Dusko, right? Yeah, Dusko, I'm about to.
Mm-hmm.
Dame Dash's response to what Steve Stout said, and his caption is, "This is the reason I had to slap the shit out of Steve Stout a couple years ago, because he's always speaking on other men's business. Good thing that I involved. Stay tuned."
How did you feel about that? I don't think men should have to be that violent, you know? Especially when they get to a certain age, you know?
No, he didn't. He said this is why he did a couple years ago, but good thing he evolved.
Yeah, that's I like that.
He didn't say he's going to use violence. That was his phrase in his caption. And I also see what Steve said. For me, it's like this with this particular situation, because I'm cool with Steven, but Dave's my big bro at the same time. So to me, it's like this. Whenever Dame does an interview, you know about 90% of the time, Jay-Z's name is going to get brought up.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like Dame is just always saying something negative or something not positive about Jay-Z. And in all fairness, if I believe y'all didn't ask him the questions, he wouldn't speak about it. But once you start asking him questions, Dame's like open book. You're going to start talking about what he knows and what they went through, et cetera, et cetera. And with Steve Stout, the situation to me is that I don't know, you know, I just seen a clip of this. I don't know how Dame's name got brought up. That's more the question for me. It's like, if you didn't bring Dame's name up, why mention him? So I would need more context how the interview went and see how it goes. But, you know, even like Steve Stout was on the Breakfast Club, he said Dame's name. And anytime, the funny thing is this, right? Steve Stout, and like I said, Steve probably going to call me later today about this when I speak to him. Or maybe not.
Yeah.
He doesn't call me. We don't speak that often. But, you know, Steve had, you know, he says things about Dame. Dame says things about Steve. But maybe about 3 or 4 years ago, Steve Stout called me and was like, yo, tell Dame I said he was right about certain things. I forget exactly what it was about, but he wanted me to deliver that message to Dame. And I did deliver the message to Dame, and I don't ever know what panned out from it. But I know that they have mutual business respect for each other. But when it gets personal, it just gets personal.
Yeah, I really don't like the way it get perceived, because if there was some things that he did right, then I would prefer that people share that as well as the bad. I don't like when people try to stack a narrative in a direction, especially, and me and Dame has never had a good relationship, but I'm a stickler for truth, and I want to know the truth, and I want to be a part of the truth. Even if I've done something that wasn't truthful, I would like to make that right so it could be truthful. You know what I'm saying? So when I hear things about Dame, it seems like people only tell the bad side because the person who has the most money is on the other side. That's the part I don't like, you know? So when I hear certain things, I don't like it. And I would want to know, you know, you being a person that it seemed like Dame put in a very powerful position, looking back at it, yep. Do you think Dame was, like, wrong, or do you think he was right about the things that he did? Even when it comes to you, do you think that was right or wrong?
Today is Ask Cam, huh?
I was saving this one. Ask Cam. The whole world want to know this, Killer, you know?
Look, the thing about it is this, is that Dame, it isn't about, to me, Dame is right a lot of times. It's his approach.
Yeah.
And he comes across aggressive. He's a quick talker, very articulate, has an extensive vocabulary, and he is street nigga. So with all that combined, and he's arrogant in a good way for me. And to me, it's funny, you know, like, when I say arrogant, like, you know, me, Mason, Dame was on a convo about a week ago and on a FaceTime. As soon as we get on the phone with Dame, he's like, yeah, look at my lake, nigga. Nah, hello, what's up, how y'all been? Yo, Mace, that's you, I ain't seen you in 15 years. How you been? Look at my lake, nigga. I'm in my lake house right now. This is how he says hello to his friends.
Yeah, those his alligators. I said, those your alligators? He said, yeah, those my alligators. Yeah. Dame, those are not your alligators.
Dame said, they're the property of Florida. The state of Florida. They said, I would take y'all to the guest house, to the main house, but it's going to take you about 9 minutes because we got to get on a go-kart to get all the way over there. This is how he says hello. I'm not even exaggerating. I'm being dead verbatim just about how he told me and Mace what's up. So when you're not cool with him and he has facts, you know, Dame will hit you with 100 facts. You're not doing this. You're not doing that. Not doing this. Not doing that. And then at the end of it, he'll say, why would you even wear them sneakers? Those shits is terrible, matter of fact. I should have known you wasn't going to do business right if you would wear sneakers like that. Like, he's that type of, like, it'll throw you off because it's like all the crazy shit that made sense he just said, and then he just starts snapping on you and the way you dress, and then he relates that to the business as like, nigga, I should have known a nigga who dressed like you wasn't ever going to do business right. But as far as doing right by me, I think if you're asking about my time at Rockefeller, what happened with this with me is plain and simple. I didn't get a good deal. What happened is I was at Entertainment and I ended up going to Epic, my second album. And when I got the Epic Records, I learned the record business. I learned who was doing promotion. I learned who was doing marketing. I learned who was doing radio. I learned why the money wasn't getting spent. I learned the niggas was stealing out my budget. And I became really aggressive in the music industry because I'm like, you know, back in them days, Mace knows you signed for 7 albums. Yeah. And I'm like, oh, these niggas are on my second album and these niggas playing my life. Yeah. So I took it like they was playing my life. And I bought 40 niggas. Shout out to my man, Luke Abrazi. He used to have the Taliban. I took niggas from 40th, niggas from 145th. And every day we went to Epic Records with 40 niggas. So they let me out my deal. Dame helped me get out my deal and I went to Rockefeller. So I said all that to say I knew the business by the time I got to Rockefeller. So when I got to Rockefeller, I came in there like an animal because I knew where marketing was. I knew where radio was, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So as soon as I got there, I hit the ground, my feet running, went into Bobby's office, which is Dave's brother. I need my radio spins because I'm going to deliver good music. Who's running marketing? I talked to marketing. A&R department, I don't need them. I don't need no A&R. I'm good. The A&R days is over, nigga. They was cool with me, but I just wasn't fucking with no A&R. I don't need you to tell me what to do for me. And then after that, I went to Def Jam, and I start more of the story is when I got there, and it's no disrespect to nobody on Rockefeller, because sometimes they take it as disrespect. I just kind of surpassed them because what happens is they was in a good deal and they never had to really learn the business. Dame, Jay, and Big did such a good job with running the company, they had the time to just be artists, to where my last deal, I didn't have time to be an artist.
Who did you pass?
Because I was an artist.
When you say who you pass, who?
When I
no names. Are you saying artists or executives?
Besides, to both. To me, it was like when I got there, the biggest artist, of course, was Jay-Z. But after that, think about it. If you know history of hip hop, and no disrespect, like Beanie was there, and State Property. And I'm not talking about record wise. I'm talking about certain things. I want to make sure I clarify.
Yeah.
Music might have been equal, or if not better, at least equal. Like, I'm just giving State Property, for example. They had the movement. We had the movement. But what happened is Jay, Dame, and Biggs did such a good job, they didn't have to learn business. I got jerked at Epic Records, so I knew the business. Not me just dealing with Def Jam. I mean, with Rockefeller, I started going upstairs to Def Jam. So Def Jam was partners with Rockefeller. So not only am I getting Rockefeller to do my music, I'm talking directly to Kevin Lyles. I'm talking directly to Leo Cohen. I'm talking directly to Julie Greenwald. I'm talking directly to Kaiser. And I'm like, I push the button downstairs. Now y'all need to push the button. And they couldn't, not saying they couldn't understand it, but like, Cam know what the fuck you talking about. Yeah, I just got jerked around. So I learned. My life was on the line. What Dame Dash told me was this, Murder, when I first got to Rockefeller, he said, look, Cam, look, you got you a second chance at this music shit. You know, we're going to see if this works, and if it don't work, we're going to give you a job. And that was like the scariest shit I ever heard in my life. But it was real, though. You got to respect that. You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, damn, I don't want no job, but we got to make this work, because you don't get a lot of chances in hip-hop. So we made it work. And that...
Yeah, I mean, so that's great, because I mean, I wasn't there. That's why I'm asking the questions. At this point, I'm in church, so I'm not really knowing what's going on. Right. So this means absolutely. Dame gave a lot of people jobs, regardless of what people say. And him giving you a platform, he gave a lot of people in Harlem jobs.
Oh, absolutely. It's a bunch of people outside of me that are still in prominent positions now. Sherry, she's the president of the Rock Nation Rave. She lived in Dame's building, Dame Dash's building in 1199. And I don't really know exactly how the college thing worked. I think, I don't know if Dame helped her get in college or helped pay for college or whatever it was. I'm not sure about that part. But she came down as an intern. Dame let her be an intern at Rockefeller. And she never looked back. You know, she's an intern, then a secretary, then an assistant, then got... went in the corporate. Then she, I think she's the assistant president at Atlantic Records. And she went over to work with Todd Moskowitz. And now she's the president of Rock Nation. And this is like Dave Dash's niece almost. And that's just one example. It's several people who's still working right now. Emmanuel, who's at Atlantic, got hired at Rockefeller. It's a lot of executives that's still working right now because of Dave. Yes.
That's huge. Yeah. Pause.
That's dope. Yeah. Those are dope questions.
Yeah, I wanted to know, because, you know, when I hear stories, I don't really know. So you're my source of information when it comes to this.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
At that time, I wasn't even listening to music. So there's a lot of stuff I missed out on.
Yeah, we definitely
absolutely.
I was going to say, we definitely have to continue the Ask Cam and Mace, because I know there's so many more things people
want to
know.
I tried to startle him, but he was ready.
Because I ain't going to lie, nigga. You know, like I said, the main question you asked me, and before we get ready to move on, is, and I don't know if it's the main question, but I want to wrap this up in saying this, is that Dame gets perceived the wrong way because of his attitude. He's very arrogant, but he's very smart. But the thing about it is, Dame is going to do what works for Dame. And at this point, you got to accept him, either love him or hate him for who he is, because he's not changing. And he's been successful at helping build $100 million companies, not just one, but multiple. And some people never going to see $100 million in their life. So I think he's capable of doing anything in the world, but sometimes, to me, to Cam, the way he presents himself to other people is eternal. He's an acquired taste, pause.
Yeah.
Okay, so into the sports. We've talked a lot about All-Star Game, what we want to see, who we want to see participate. Zion Williamson said, I got to do my part and make the All-Star game. If I'm in the All-Star game, I'll do the dunk contest. But if not, I'm not doing it. So what do you guys think about his logic?
Cam, you go first on that. Pause.
All I'm going to say is I am going to be an All-Star next year. That ain't even – Zion can average 5 points and six and minus six rebounds. Because there's such jeopardy year after year after year of having a big disappointing All-Star weekend, that Zion is very interesting to be in the dunk contest. That's somebody who people want to see. And maybe he may attract other names to come in the dunk contest. I remember we said this last week, if it was last week or not the week before, that we would love to see Zion and Ja Morant in the dunk contest. And I think the NBA knows this. I think Zion put some numbers to possibly be an All-Star. You know, we'll see how his health is next year, so on and so forth. But we got to realize is that the West is stacked. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of younger players aren't going anywhere. So he's going to have to earn to be an All-Star. To me, this kind of sounds like a cry to say, you better make me an All-Star, nigga. If y'all want that dunk contest shit popping,
yeah,
I need to be an All-Star. Y'all figure that shit out.
That's what I heard when I heard it. Niggas basically saying, make me an All-Star. Y'all niggas want me to do the dunk contest. Make me an All-Star.
Yep, exactly.
But I think he can get enough votes. I think if he's healthy the whole season and he stay away from the parties and the food, he could definitely be an All-Star. I mean, Zion have all of the tools, pause, to be a Hall of Fame player if he locks in. So Zion, lock in. We want to see you the All-Star. We want to see you in the dunk contest, and I want to see you as a Hall of Fame player because I think that's the pedigree that you belong to. So. Make us look smart.
There we go. Okay, moving on.
Yeah, real quick. I was just going to say that he has the potential to do it.
Yeah.
I just don't like the way he said this today. I'm going to be honest with you because it's almost strong arming.
Yeah.
He's from
South Carolina. He's supposed to try that.
I mean, whatever. I don't care where you from. I'm not mad at that. I'm not mad at nothing.
You want this from me? I need to be in the All-Star game. How about we both win?
Listen, me and Mace, I don't know if we even talked about it on camera or off camera, but we was talking about how back when we played New York City basketball, at least public school, wasn't as recognized as much as Catholic school. And kind of during the era we played, they started paying a little more attention to public school. Not saying that the people before us wasn't good. But what I'm saying all that to say this is that they wanted me and Mace, and we talked about it because it wasn't at the same time. Mm-hmm. And they asked me to come back to the high school reunion, and it was going to be a basketball game. They wanted me to come back, and I told them, if you retire my jersey, I'll come back. I mean, I'm not going to come back unless you retire my jersey. If you don't retire my jersey, I don't really want to come back. It's just not going to make sense for me to talk to anybody because, no disrespect, I'm probably the most popping nigga out the joint. Not saying I don't miss my classmates and all that, but I don't really need to go back. I didn't graduate. That's first and foremost. So I have nothing positive to say. You know, when they come to ask me, you know, Murder, they be like, yo, Cam, we want you to come talk to this school. I'm like, you sure? Yes, if I tell them what I did to get where I'm at, I'm pretty sure y'all wouldn't want me to come talk to y'all school. So I'm not mad at a nigga trying it because I tried a lot of times.
Yeah, and it's crazy because we weren't speaking and I told them the same exact thing. So I know they was like, wow, you sure they're not speaking? Because Mace came up here and said the same thing. I said, yo, y'all want me to come? Pause. I need the 22 in the rafters, man. I need nobody to be able to wear that number.
Yeah, that's what type of time I was on.
Okay, moving along. Jordan Poole says today's generation is about the views and the clickbait. He said, I'm more of an old soul, if that makes sense. So that goes to the new generation who wants to post everything. It's about the views. It's about the clickbait. It's about making fun of people online. that's just what's hot. He also gave examples of how he doesn't have to post when he goes to the gym because he's working out. The whole world doesn't need to see that. Do you guys agree with his standpoint and what he said?
Well, let me start by saying this. I believe a lot of what you're saying, Jordan Poole, and I'm going to be straightforward so you know everybody is not trying to be clickbait. Everybody is not trying to just make fun of you because it's a hot thing to do. If you're not recording that you're working out, we don't know because the games are not showing that you're working out. And I don't mean that in a funny way. You know, if you are working out, then we're expecting that to show up in the game. When you go from this such high level at Golden State and then you go to a team that is supposed to be your team now, we're expecting you. I know I was expecting you to have the James Harden first year in Houston year. So you made me look bad and the people who vouch for you. And I'm expecting you to turn that around because you don't have to be a part of a beta generation. You don't have to be a part of that where everybody just is the victim all the time. Because that's what it seemed like you're doing. You're saying you're not a part of this generation. But it does give the undertone of a beta generation where you're just the victim of being in the wrong generation. How about live above your generation? How about live beyond where everybody else is? I'm going to turn it over to Killer because I could go on for an hour about this because this is a conversation I'm very passionate about. I'm not just passionate about people being beta. I'm going to say what I'm about to say because we'll get kicked off the air for what I'm about to say. Go ahead, Killer. I was about to lose it. I was about to catch a flashback. I was about to snap.
All I gotta do is say, stop crying, nigga. This sound like some bitch got you on tape and you don't want it exposed. That's all this sound like to me, nigga. Yo,
think of that. You right?
Stop posting everything. We gotta keep shit a secret. Then he trying to swerve it.
Oh,
I don't post my workouts. Nah, nigga, you be mixy, nigga, with these bitches. You mad mixy. You just want to keep it low, and I respect that. Because you know why we in the generation? I get it. You know why I respect why you want to keep it quiet? Because this is what I was talking about earlier, and this is generations. I'm glad I've been around to see a lot of shit, and I'm still a loopy nigga. Because at the end of the day, I remember it was a crime if a nigga told another nigga he fucked a bitch. This nigga run his mouth. And you might not fuck the bitch no more when I was a teenager or early 20s because you was running your mouth. Now, girls is running their mouth. And not just running their mouth to their friends, running their mouth on social media. If a nigga do what girls be doing, nigga be a bitch ass nigga. You a rat. Oh, you run around saying, you know, some niggas do it. But a girl will get up there and be like, oh, this nigga here, he acting like he ain't fucking with me. He fucked me raw, all type of shit. Taking pictures while niggas sleep cuddled under their arms, posting it. Niggas in there acting like they wasn't there. I remember James Harden, and I don't mean to bring it up, but it's on the net. Mm-hmm. He was under some bitch arms. Niggas said, nah, that ain't me. That's Photoshop. These bitches out here talking. They can't wait to tell who they fuck. They can't Photoshop. Wait to say nothing.
They can say AI. Yo, that wasn't me on the phone. That's AI.
Yeah. You get what I'm saying? So now, that's the reason I said I feel him because maybe I'm a little older and I remember if a nigga ran his mouth, it was crazy, man. Look, I don't even want to get into high school mix. I ain't know half the shit niggas was doing. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, word murder? You ain't saying nothing? I'm your man. I'm like, yo, murder, I'm your man. What you doing walking down First Avenue during second period, nigga?
I thought you lived on the west side.
Yeah. School this way. Why are you walking this way? Yeah, I'll see you in lunch, Killer. You see me in lunch? Where's you going, nigga?
Yeah.
like murder, look. And this is why I'm mad about certain shit. He ain't telling me because in high school, ain't gonna go crazy. I just want to say one thing. Yeah. I ain't going crazy. But in high school, one of his main girlfriends, very, very, very pretty young lady. Very pretty young lady. You know, that's his girlfriend. That's my sister. But you should have seen the joint I had to take for the team. Her best friend. Yo. Crazy, man. I'm taking shit for the team at this point. I'm like, yo, this is wild, man. You going to sneak and not tell me everything? Man, no one's seen this joint I was taking for the team. It's crazy, man. It's crazy, man.
That was wild. That was wild. That was wild.
That was wild.
Yeah, that was crazy. Oh, man.
Yeah. So back to Jordan Poole. Yeah, it was crazy, yeah, man. It was crazy. But Jordan Poole, if that's the scenario, cool. But, you know, this gives me Sin City vibes. You know, Sin City's name has been brought up on this show at least once a week for the last 2 months because he's been to ridiculous shit like this. Sin tells me, because you was getting into it a little bit, Murder, before you cut yourself off. I guess you're about to go somewhere else. The show probably don't need to go. But the nigga Sin tells me, you know, and he don't even talk about this generation's clicks. He told my man, I was supposed to be born with Nicky Barnes and them niggas, man. Frank Luciano, and then he start naming mobsters from the 60s. Talking about, that's with a serious face, that, I miss my time. I say, Sin, you be dead by now. He say, yeah, maybe I should have been dead when they died. So when you sitting there talking about that ass, so when you sitting there talking about what you was about to get into, Mace, about this era and this, that, and the third. First of all, you're 23, 24 years old. You're part of this era, Jordan Poole, whether you want to realize it or not. You're this era. So you're not even like 31 to be like, yeah, them 19-year-old. You're 23 or 24 years old. I think, matter of fact, you're 24 years old. So at the end of the day, this is your generation. And
he's an old soul, though, killer. He's an old soul. That's what he's saying.
I dig it, but at the same time, I'm older for facts, and I'm not crying. I'm figuring it out. I can't sit there. Sin gonna tell me he mad ain't no more payphones in New York. Do I miss them? No, I don't miss them. No, I don't. I have a phone in my pocket, nigga. You got to figure out what's going on. All this technology. Niggas be mad at certain technology and then cool with other technology. You know, yo, it's too much going on in the gram, but you want to get in your car and use maps to get to where you're going.
Mm-hmm.
No, which one? Do you want technology or you don't want technology? Some of it's good, some of it's unnecessary, some of it's extra. I dig that. But stop crying about this generation and what I always do. Like even Devin Booker. Devin Booker may be 28, 29. He got up there and said a week ago, man, it was crazier to get 70 points back in my day. What day, Devin Booker? Nigga, how old are you? What are you talking about back in your day?
Yeah, these niggas is old souls, killer. I understand them. It's like, You feel like you don't belong with the people because you don't have the same mindset as everybody. You know what that's like, Stat?
I definitely know what that's like.
It's like you're there, but you're not there because everything they think, everything they're about to do, everything they feel, you don't feel. Everything they see, the way they see it, you don't see it. It to make an example of it is like this. I'll come back to it. It's just... I gotta process it, you know.
Listen, I totally understand what you're saying 100%. I get it. Same thing I tell this nigga. I totally get it. But the problem is this, and I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about Jordan Poole or anybody else. It's a difference between understanding where you're coming from and it's another thing to just deal with what's going on in reality. You can sit there and complain, but we not going backwards.
Yeah.
It's not in society. It's not. Listen, that's why I said I get it. It's a lot of shit I can complain about. It's a lot of shit that I can be like, man, niggas getting over on this.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's not going nowhere. So instead of complaining about it, what are you going to do to figure it out to move forward? That's all I'm saying, because if you sit there and keep crying and crying and crying, and you're not doing nothing about it, then you're just going to be an old soul stuck in a new world. That's just what's going to happen.
It's that like was eating, fire.
That was.
It's like, yeah, but that's a fact. You know what I'm saying? It's like my nigga Duke, he be mad, you know, Duke the God, he mad at this person. You know, I don't get into politics, but, you know, Trump and Biden and this, and he got his own views of everything, and he always saying what niggas should do. And I tell the nigga, you got a congregation of zero, nigga. Malcolm X started with six niggas in a room at least.
Yeah.
You don't even be giving a speech to four or five niggas.
Yeah.
So you're just sitting here on the phone complaining to me when you want to move the movement. Now, if you got a congregation of 100,000, I can be like, nah, that's my cousin. That's Duke the God, nigga. You know how he's moving out here. I can't represent with you. You ain't moving, nigga. You ain't moving. I ain't down with your movement, man. When you get high, I jump on a bandwagon. Till further notice, all you're doing is crying amongst a group of people about what's right and what's not right. And that's all I'm saying about the situation. Me, totally understanding where he's coming from. I dig it. But as far as moving forward in life, we're not going back to payphones if that's what niggas is looking for. We're not going back to that shit murder. Remember when you said, and I know Stab, no idea what I'm talking about. I'm talking about Mace, when you're standing on the corner and they got the box and then you can push the fire department or the police department. That shit ain't going back, bro.
Yeah.
This is over, my nigga. So that's all I was saying about that.
That's real.
Not that I don't understand.
No, I totally accept what you said, and I appreciate it because that brings me to my next point. Then that means that everybody that feels that way, you have to do something to change the way things are. You got to, even if it start with something small. Like I'm gonna go first for all of the people that feel like, you know, this world should be different. Think of something you can do that can make it better and change it from the way you see it going. Like, to me, I see people like totally being super selfish about everything. And even when we was talking about Dame Dash, I feel like more people are like Dame Dash, but they're like that behind the scenes. They have the same arrogance. They have the same rudeness and everything, but they're just behind the scenes. So that's why I didn't like it. So I don't like niggas being house niggas. I don't like niggas being fighting to be the nigga of all niggas just so you could be the top nigga that tell everybody what to say. And I would put names on it because there's two names I'm thinking about. They have sports agencies, but I'm not going to go there. I'm going to save that for Friday. I'm really paused, feeling crazy right now. I don't like nobody disrespecting Harlem. We're not going to have it, ever going to have it. But what I would say is this. I'm going to start doing birthday parties, performing at all my fans' birthday parties. So that's what I'm going to start from. It is what it is, giving and paying it forward, because I want to see something different. And I think I need to start by doing something musically until I get ready to do some music or something like that. So if you got a birthday party coming up, you want me to perform at your birthday party, send it to Mace at All Things Mace. Mace at allthingsmace.com.
There you have it. Mace at allthingsmace.com. On that note, we're going to go to break. And when we return, we will talk about a particular team that passed on Travis Kelce.
She called this thing about toxic. 4 years and counting. Got you feeling like an option. Maybe I'm my own problem, babe. She tired of hearing, I don't know. My stubborn in me won't fall. Oh, oh. Dealing with this thing called trust. But she really thinking about
she
it.
She wanna be free.
Welcome back. Now let's get into our Underdog Fantasy picks of the day. Tonight, the Mavs will play the Heat. Underdog Fantasy has Luka at 33.5 points. Do you have him higher or lower, Mace?
Lower. I think he's going to have right there, probably like 30, 32. He's going to have a lot, but not over 33.
Okay. Cam?
It's a tough one, man, because Luka seems pretty unstoppable. It seems like he does what he wants to do when he wants to do it. The question is Jimmy Butler going to accept the challenge? So I'm going to go lower.
Okay, and Jimmy Butler is at 5.5 first quarter points. Do you have him higher or lower, Cam?
I'm going to go higher.
Yeah, I'm going to go higher too.
Okay, and Bam is at 10.5 rebounds. Do you have him higher or lower, Mace?
Higher. You know Bam is going to have more than 10 rebounds. Killer, come on. This is going to be the first time we had all the same answers. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm going to go higher. Right. We had all the same answers yesterday.
Oh.
Download the Underdog Fantasy app, and you can make your picks, too.
Mace, Nick, where you at, Nick?
I'm right here, bro. Look at the screen. Hey, Mace, my birthday's this
we
weekend.
Can't hear
so
you.
I'm going to take that offer.
Your mic is off, Nick.
Yo, Mace, I'm going to take that offer on that birthday, bro, because my birthday's this weekend. So put your money where your mouth is, you know what I'm saying?
Your birthday is this weekend. Nigga, Nick said his birthday is this weekend.
It's like you performing this weekend. Shout out, Nick.
Now, don't try to put me in the wrong club now. Come on, I gotta have a say-so on where I perform. Nah, let me stop.
Okay. So, Travis Kelce insists the Cowboys pass on him in the 2013 NFL draft because of red flags and smoking weed. He said he had some bad interviews and, quote, the Cowboys, they were kind of pressing me about having this red flag of missing a year. What did you guys think when you heard the story?
Now, I'll say this little piece and then Cam go, and I want to come back, pause after he finish. I think if he would have made it to the Cowboys, he would not be the player that we're looking at today. And I want to just say that. What do you think, Killer?
I think this is a great time to tell this story. Mm-hmm. I don't know the details of how the interviews went or his mishaps with weed or missing a year or so on and so forth, but he's coming towards the end of his career, and I'm not saying he doesn't have a few years left, but, you know, he could have told this story after the first Super Bowl or after the second Super Bowl. Well, he said, you know what? Now it's time. I want to bring it up, especially with the success that the Kansas City Chiefs had and the regular old Cowboys we've known for the last 35 years of not winning. So I think it's a great time to tell the story. This is the era we're in now where people are telling stories. So I'm pretty sure he has some interesting stories besides that one. But to me, what you just said, I agree with you, Don. Now, Jason Witten had a great career as a tight end with the Cowboys.
Yeah.
And a lot of people have great careers with the Cowboys, but it doesn't equate to winning. Tony Romo was decent. What's my nigga said? Zeke Elliott, he's out the building. He had a great start with the Cowboys. Emmitt Smith, Troy Aikman. I'm not going to count them because they won championships. I'm talking about the people who haven't. They always get some good players, even Dez Bryant. But it doesn't equate to winning. And being that Travis Kelce is a three-time Super Bowl champion, proven a big part of the championships. It isn't like he's no bum-ass nigga and didn't contribute to these championships. I don't mind the story at all. I would like to hear more about it. I didn't actually hear what he said. But I think it's a decent time to tell the story because if you do it after the first Super Bowl and then the Cowboys end up being successful 2-3 Super Bowls later, and get on a run, then you'll be like, I should have shut the fuck up. But nah, he waited to the right time to say what he needed to say. I got three, but time they went three, I might be out of here, so whatever. Wasn't during my time.
Yeah. I just think at his position, it would have been more pressure on him to perform at the Dallas Cowboys. Another thing is they didn't draft him, they said, because of character issues. Now, think of all of the people that went there since him that has had major character issues. I thought that was a real funny statement that he didn't make it there, and it was stemming from character concerns that they had at the Cowboys organization. Another thing I thought about when it comes to Travis Kelce is that when he's playing for Kansas City, you know, Title Town, that he was selected, I think, 62nd. And when you think of the people that was picked before him, it makes no sense. It made absolutely no sense, especially if the Cowboys could have gotten him. But once he passed Jerry Rice, I think that's the only thing they would have loved to have is somebody in a Cowboys uniform that passed Jerry Rice all-time catches record.
Well, you know, at the same time, you may not pass that record if you don't have Patrick Mahomes either.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a big part of the receptions as well. You got to also think Patrick Mahomes wasn't going to be at the Cowboys. So what I'll say is this, but you just building off something you just said. The thing about it is they probably didn't think he was going to be the player that he was. Because when you're saying the Cowboys take on people with problems or character issues, so on and so forth, they believe in you. They say, this nigga's a headache, but we could win. This nigga might be a problem, but we're going to be able to win. So if they thought it was character issues, they just didn't believe in him as a player. Because they definitely take on niggas with character issues.
Yeah, that's what I was saying all the time. So for him to be the one that got excluded is crazy.
Right. Yeah, they just probably didn't believe in him as a player.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I always say everything does happen for a reason. So he's in the best situation he could be in right now. Okay, so 11-year NBA vet Isaiah Thomas will be returning to basketball this season with Utah Jazz's G League team, the Salt Lake City Stars. He's looking to make his NBA comeback. What do you guys think about his efforts?
Mm. Isaiah Thomas, I think he can help most of the teams that are contenders right now. It's just this weird thing about him. Not even weird. It's just this great thing about him as a player. He can fit, pause, any system. Because when it comes down to the playoff teams and you need somebody to go out there and just get 12 points or 14 points that can make all the difference, I think he can do that in any of the top six teams. He would be able to do that on Denver. He would be able to do that. They wouldn't let him in Boston, but he could do that in Boston. He would be able to do that in OKC. Just different places that he can come off the bench like a six man, like Jamal Crawford used to do, and just go crazy. I could see him doing that on a lot of teams. He would be great at the Suns. Actually, what they will probably need, and as well as who else I'm thinking about? Not Miami, but any one of the other teams. Philadelphia definitely would be great as well. Just to come off the bench and get about 12 to 16 points and help the team to go to a win. I would love this.
Yeah, I like Isaiah Thomas a lot. Even how Jamal Crawford came up here on the show and says Isaiah still wakes up at 5-6 in the morning, trains, early afternoon training, still hoping for a shot. I think this is great. He's in the G League, but if you're asking me to be serious and answer the question, I don't think he's getting another shot.
Yeah.
Mace brought up Denver. Reggie Jackson's the backup point guard for Jamal Murray. They only run about 7, maybe 8 players in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. The Suns have Eric Gordon coming off the bench. They're guard-orientated already. And right now, I think that a team would rather invest in somebody who's younger and get experience to move forward as a franchise. He's 34, 35 years old. I'm not sure. But last time I checked, I believe he's 34 years old. That's getting old for an NBA player, especially one that hasn't played in a couple years. I really just feel bad for Isaiah Thomas because he got such a raw deal. That man's sister died in the middle of a playoff series in Boston. He came back to play with a messed up hip, gave it that franchise is all. He was scheduled for a nine-figure deal. When he gets traded for Kyrie to go to the Cavs, they finally realized that his hip isn't what he thought it was. And then he ends up getting no money, not any real money, not close to the money he was supposed to get. So I'm more mad about that for Isaiah Thomas, being that he gave Boston his heart, his soul, did everything he could. And then in the midst of a death, his sister, he put the franchise on his back as much as he could with a messed up hip. Now, if you're asking Danny Ainge at the time, who was the GM for Boston, you could get Kyrie Irving I might have to make that trade as well. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just being totally honest about it. And it just been downhill ever since. I wish him to get back in the NBA. I hope he does. You know, he has my prayers and my wishes. But if you're asking me to be realistic, I doubt it. I don't see him getting back in the NBA, especially now the playoffs are coming up. And roster spots are going anywhere, but teams' playing time is going to shrink. Playoffs isn't 10, 11 people playing. It's a maximum of 8. And you get 9, 10 players if somebody's in foul trouble or so on and so forth. But I wish him the best, but I have to be realistic. I don't see it being reality.
Do you think when you say this about him not playing as a reality is due to him playing, or do you think he could have possibly pissed the wrong person off?
Well, you could tell even he's, you know, when you're good, you're kind of arrogant. I don't know his attitude today, but I remember I was watching the game when he was the man in Boston, and they asked him a question after the game, and Brad Stevens was the coach at the time, and he was like, they asked him something about Brad Stevens, and he was like, you know, I'll be trying to let him coach and do his thing, but I got to do what I got to do. And I kind of like that.
This is where that come back to haunt you.
Yeah, exactly. I kind of liked it as a fan watching the game, but, you know, how does that sound for your point guard to say that to the media about your head coach?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll be trying to let the nigga coach and do all that, what he's been trying to do, but, you know, I got to do what I got to do.
Yeah, so, and now that head coach is the GM.
Right, exactly. Exactly. So I don't know his attitude in locker rooms, on the court, so on and so forth, but when you used to be that nigga, that's kind of your mentality. Mm-hmm. And then when they want you to play a different role, sometimes you're not always mentally capable of playing a different role. Not saying he isn't, and not saying he's not willing to. Jamal Crawford said that just as well. They say Jamal Crawford, when he was on the show, he said Isaiah could be on any team and give you the, what Mace was just talking about, not necessarily the points, but the, you know, 11 to 13 minutes, and not only that, bring veteran leadership to your locker room and give examples to the young players. But if you haven't been in the league for a couple years, I just don't see it being a reality. Last time he was in the G League, he got called up, I believe, by the Lakers for a few games, didn't work out, and we kind of haven't heard from him since. So I'm happy he's getting this opportunity, and I don't want to seem rude and saying I don't hope he make it. I really, really do. But realistically, 34 years old, haven't played in a couple years, and it's a bunch of young guns coming in from high school, going to the G League or coming in from overseas. The scouting is crazy now in the NBA. It's not just America. They're going around the world to find the best players. Him being 5'9 does not help at all. I don't have his stats in front of me to tell you what his field goal or three-point percentage is, but being 5'9 at 34 years old is not in your favor.
Killer shot of them.
I like the nigga. I'm just saying, what you say, Murder? We get paid to tell the truth.
Yeah, we get paid to tell the truth. Yeah, niggas be getting mad. Niggas see you walking somewhere like, yo, Mace, why you say this? I said, bro, it's the truth. Tell me when I lie.
Yeah.
He said, oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, and then his stats, just so you guys have it, he was averaging 17.7 points, 2.4 rebounds, 4.8 assists, and then 43.4% field goal percentage. So,
those are good numbers.
Those are really good numbers.
How old is he?
35.
You went 35. Up a number.
Yeah.
Okay. Draymond Green says, at this time, Victor Wembanyama doesn't deserve Defensive Player of the Year and implies that if he wins it, then we might as well give Jason Tatum MVP. So do you guys think Wemby is a legit candidate for Defensive Player of the Year? And then do you guys agree with his take?
This is one of those situations, Killer, where we just saw with with Zion. Niggas is trying to Debo their way into a war.
Listen,
it's possible for two things to be right at the same time. It's possible for Wembe to be the defensive player of the year. I'm just saying hypothetically, not that he has to. And Jason Tatum not be the MVP. Or vice versa, it's possible for Tatum to be the MVP without Wembe. You don't have to collectively put everything together. And this is one of those things, when I think of Wembe, the kind of blocks that he's having, I can see somebody giving him, they're going to give him something. Pause. They're going to give him something. We already know that. He is the one they want to be the unicorn of the future. So if it's close to giving him the award, it makes more sense for the NBA and his brand to give him the award, right? The Defensive Player of the Year and Rookie of the Year, then it's kind of setting him up to be the new face of the NBA if he can get some new talent there and win some games. And I'm not saying this is right. I'm just saying this looks like the direction they're going in. The stat is beginning to rub off on me. That would be her take.
Is a very me take. Cam, what do you think?
Yes.
He just had 7 block shots.
Yeah.
7 block shots is a lot of blocks.
Yeah, that screams defensive player of the year. 7 blocks. Yeah,
7 block shots is a lot. Hold on, let me pull up what I just had. Because, what's his rebound stat? Because I can't find a page of the more zone. But what's his rebounds average? While she's looking for that,
He has 10.3.
I'll say this.
10.3.
I don't know where Jason Tatum caught a stray from. Like, it wasn't a stray, but I don't know how Jason Tatum got into the argument.
Yeah, the nigga's leveraging Jason Tatum for his own defensive player of the year.
Yeah, but this is what I'm trying to say. I don't even – basically, I take that as a shot at Jason Tatum to me, because basically, if you're Draymond, you're saying Wemby doesn't deserve a defensive player of the year, then you're saying – Jason Tatum don't deserve it neither.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's why I said two things could be true at the same time, or they don't have to be. It's just like these niggas just beat y'all by 50. What are you talking about?
Yeah, that was to me a shot at Jason Tatum. Like, well, if you want to give it to him, you might as well just give that nigga that shit too. That's how I took it. But as far as Wemby, look, to me, I equate a lot with what you help your team do. And I was watching, and I like watching Tim Legler over at ESPN. I'm a Tim Legler fan. And he was saying how joining the Spurs organization may be the best thing Wemby best team or franchise Wemby may have went to, because they're handling it delicately, so to speak. And what he meant by that, Tim Legler, that is that they're not putting pressure on him to win. They're not putting pressure on him to say, go get it done. They're letting him feel out America, letting him feel how the NBA game is being played, and letting him grow into his part and let him do what he do without putting pressure on him to win. So when you look at the San Antonio Spurs record, you're like, damn, these niggas is last. This the Spurs. These niggas fucking up Greg Popovich's record, so on and so forth. And that's how I was looking at it until I seen that take from Tim. And I was like, you know what? They may be just letting him get his feet wet. Come here, see how the game goes. Because every night, whether win or lose, and it's not a lot of winning, his numbers are great.
Yeah, he's 20-10.
His numbers look good. Yeah, every night his numbers are great. So that's screaming, if you're Wemby's agent and you're talking to the Spurs, you're sitting saying, well, he needs some help. I know he's the unicorn, the alien, and so on and so forth, but nobody does it.
Yeah, he need a spaceship if he's an alien. Where's his spaceship?
Right. Exactly. So with numbers like that, you can't really be mad at him. But I still, back to the eye test with me, it still hasn't seen that yo, give me the rock and move. I still haven't seen that. And maybe they'll groom him into that. Like I said, he's not even from America. He seems kind of passive as a person. And he needs some dog instinct. And maybe that'll come over time. Look, we're dealing with a 20-year-old kid. So it isn't like we don't have a bunch of time with him. But at the end of the day, look, I need to see the dog in him. Because the people that we look at, the greats, and whether it's LeBron James, Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant. I'm not going to put Kobe because Kobe wasn't that good from the jump immediately. But the greats that we know are going to wheel some wins out of this, more than 12 wins. It's just going to be some nights you're going to be like, nah, fuck that. I'm just not having it tonight. And that could carry for at least 11 wins with that attitude. Sometimes an attitude can get you 11 wins in an 82-game season. And I still haven't seen that from Wimby. But I did like Tim Legler's take, and I say, you know, let's give Wimby another season and see where he's at. As far as stats are concerned, his stats are screaming defensive player of the year. But for me, the wins also matter. So with such a terrible record that the Spurs have, I wouldn't give it to him, not because of what the reason Draymond is given, but for me, the Spurs record has something to do with it as well.
That was a decent take. But Killer, what did you mean by when you said you need to see the dog in him?
Like, when I said that, I was kind of like saying that he doesn't have that attitude to be like, yo, come on, my nigga, we gonna win tonight. Fuck this. Because sometimes it'd be 3-4 point games they losing. They only losing by 3 or 4. Sometimes if you see the clock and you down by 3 points and it's a minute left, in your brain you're going to say, yo, we winning right now. So when I said the dog and them paws, that's what I meant. It wasn't nothing like you yesterday when you was talking about male sex symbols with their shirts off.
Yeah.
It was more than a rock.
I didn't say that, but we heard you say you need to see the dog and them.
Nope. If you want, you know, I wasn't going to be petty. I did say that, but see, Murder, this is what I'm going to tell you, Murder. This is what I'm going to tell you. I was being nice because you know why?
Yeah.
Nick taped everything you said. We just didn't put it on the show. Everything you said. If you want me to release everything you said, pause, before we started filming yesterday, let me know.
Yeah.
It's already recorded. In case you think we didn't record it,
this revenge pause? Let me know.
No,
are you in the revenge pause mode? Because it was just crazy. This is what I don't understand with you.
No, it's definitely revenge because I was being nice about it. Because the thing about it is this, stat, for some reason, just doesn't want to admit it, but you didn't know I was listening.
That was the one told me that what you just said.
No, I'm talking about yesterday. Fine, you know what? I'll put the tape up. But if you want to do this, what I'm saying is you was talking to stat.
I kill all like, I asked you was, yo, all I asked you was, what do you mean when you say you need to see the dog? That's all I asked.
And
Killer,
I gave you a very
all right,
articulate
so why,
answer.
Now, why are you mad with me? I just asked the question.
I'm not mad. I'm just saying, I answered the question. Now I want to make a statement. My statement was you didn't know nobody was listening, and you said, stat, for us to be number one, is I'm going to have to become a sex symbol like one of them niggas. You ever see The Rock?
That's not what I said.
So what did you say? It's 2 days straight. Yeah. What did you say?
You're trying to spin it from the dog that you needed to see.
No, I told you that. All I'm asking you is, you need to see the dog, crazy?
That's all I want to know is you saying you need to see the dog. Is that crazy?
I said I need to see the dog in him, and realistically, that's bestiality. That's not even pause.
Okay.
No, that's
all right.
That's really not. That's you reaching. You right now. You Patrick Beverly. You reaching. That's all I'm saying.
You Pat Bevin right now, bro. Yo,
I'm
Pat
gonna move
gonna
on.
Be,
you got that.
Pat no, gonna be mad at that. You Pat Bevin right now.
Yeah.
Yo.
In it's like, I know Cam. Cam posts, obviously, I hope you guys are following Cam on Instagram, but Cam posts clips from the show. I just feel like the next clip just might be a clip.
Because listen, so Mace might not have seen it. I posted the clip about you with The Rock, and all the comments are saying, Mace, why you won't say what you say? Why you keep asking Steph to go on with the show? Mace, what did you say about The Rock? It's 300 people up there that want to know what you say. So they'll see it again tomorrow. They'll see it again today.
Well, on that note, that is all the time we have for today. Thanks for watching. And as always, it is what it is. Two Big Macs, like when they doing them 2 for 5.